So this morning I'm going to sing one of my favorite songs. How many of you have had a week? You know, like this week has been a tough week. How many of y'all had a tough week? Tough day? Tough month? Tough year? But you know, God knows all about it, and He knows everything that you're going through. You may not think He does, but He does. He's not surprised when things happen. We are. But He is not surprised. And He knows everything. He knows your name. He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. He knows my name. And oh, how He walks with me. Oh, how He talks with me. Oh, how You tell me that I am Your own. Oh, how You walk with me. Oh,
you know.
'Cause I can't make it without you, not one day without you, Jesus. I can't make it without him, 'cause I need you, Jesus. Yes, I can't make it without you. You know my name. You know my name. You know my name. You with me, and oh, how you walk with me, and oh, how you talk with me, and oh, how you tell me that I am. Sweep over us right now, Jesus. You are in this room, Jesus. You are my strength, my strong tower, my refuge, my fortress, and I run to you, Jesus. I run to you, Jesus. Oh, I run to you, Jesus. Oh, I run to you, Jesus. Some of you need to hear this. I don't know. Might be just for me. I don't know. Do you need to hear this morning? That he knows your name? I'm reading in Psalms along with my other readings. Always reading Psalms. And the verse this morning that stood out to me was, "For every beast of the forest is mine, and the cattle on a thousand hills. I know all the birds of the mountains, and the wild beast of the field, they're mine. If I were hungry, I wouldn't tell you. For the world is mine, and all its fullness." Found peace in that this morning, that the world is his. The world is his, and he knows exactly where you're at this morning. Sing that one more time. Get it in your spirit. That you know my name. Yes, you know my name. Ooh. Yes, you know my name. Oh, yeah, yes. You know my name. Oh, how. And oh, how. Oh, how you talk with me. And oh, how you tell me that I am back with shouts of acclamation and take me home. What joy shall fill my heart then I shall bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my because of who you are, Lord. There's no one like you, Lord.
So great. He was able to reach down to where I was and pick me up. I don't know how he was able to make a difference between me and the dirt I was up in, but God cleaned me up and he made me a brand new creature. That's how great my God is. Give him a hand clap of praise this morning. Hallelujah. Y'all may be seated. We're going to be talking about going on a trip of a lifetime. Amen. You want to turn to Acts 4:10, we'll be reading there. How many of y'all have ever started preparing to go on a trip that you were just so excited about going on? Anybody? Oh, I tell you, I've planned for different trips in my life. I remember as a kid, my mom and dad would every now and then they would take us, when my dad was still working in the oil field, we would go on vacation to Florida. We'd go to the beach, you know, and that was, you know, we lived in the piney woods of Gina, so the only sand we saw was sand in the ball field, so that was a good thing. And then after I got married, you know, we would make some plans, and there were some destinations I wasn't so thrilled about, others that I liked, but a couple of years ago, for our 25th anniversary as pastors of Bayou Blue Assembly of God, the church sent us to Israel. Man. You talk about anticipation. There was such an anticipation in me. I thought about all the things. And you know what? I didn't care about doing anything else. I wanted to go to Israel. Now, there were some people that were sidetracked a little bit. And when we got to New York, they wanted to go and look at other stuff. I told them I didn't want to go nowhere else. I just wanted to get to Israel. That was all my mind was on that. But there was a handful, seven of them that decided they wanted to go and look. And they went and they were a little sidetracked. They got a whole lot more traveling done than I did that trip. But I got to where I wanted to be and did what I wanted to do. I'm not going to go into detail. Some of y'all, some are happy. Some are saying the story needs to be told. But you know, the thing is that I was just so excited that nothing else even mattered to me. All I wanted to do was get to Israel. I wanted to see. And so I was this anticipation. And so as I was praying about direction and God began to just move in my heart, he said, there needs to be an anticipation and an excitement in my people about the trip we're getting ready for. Amen. I don't know if y'all know this, but there's going to be a call someday. And only those people that are ready are going to get to go. And so I'm excited about that. And so as God began to stir in my heart, I began to see some things that we have to do when we're preparing for a trip. And so I just want to go over And we're going to probably the next few weeks we'll be talking about some different aspects of this. But getting ready for the trip of a lifetime. In Acts 4:10 says, "Be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom ye crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him doth this man stand here before you whole. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which is become the head of the corner. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. Father, be with me and allow me to speak the word that you gave me. I ask that, Lord God, you would allow me to speak into the heart of your people. Father, I bind the enemy and anything he would do to come to take away these moments that we have. And we ask that you would just touch us in Jesus' name. Amen. So, you know, one of the first things that you have to do when you're getting ready to go on a trip is you have to make sure that the vehicle you're going in can make it. Isn't that right? Anybody ever gone on a trip in a vehicle that didn't make it? Sad, isn't it? You know, you get everything ready, everything's packed, you get about 10 miles down the road and you run out of gas. You think, who is supposed to put gas in this thing? You know, or you get into a rainstorm and you turn the windshield wipers on and they don't work. You know, or you're down the road a little bit and you have a blowout, you get out and you ain't no spare tire. Well, that's some poor planning, isn't it? That'll ruin a vacation too, by the way. And even if you recover, sir, you're never getting over it. Because your wife and kids ain't never going to let you forget you didn't check the oil, you didn't look at the tires, and you didn't make sure everything was working. Because we all know it's our fault, right? Come on. You know, and so there's a process that we have to take. Well, we need to make sure that the vehicle that we are holding on to for eternity is going to get to heaven. You need to understand that every doctrine out there is not a doctrine that will get you into heaven. Just everything that people say isn't necessarily the truth. And we really need to be careful what it is we're believing and hanging on to, because there is so many lies that are out in the world today that if you don't listen to what they're saying, they'll lie to you and make you think they're telling you the truth, because they will take a little bit of truth and they will twist a little bit of lie into that thing so that they can deceive us and cause us to hang on to something that's not quite right. And you need to know that there is only one name, it said, that's going to get you to heaven. Amen. There's not salvation in any other way. No other how, no other religious belief is going to get you to heaven. There are not many paths that lead to God. There is one, and His name is Jesus. That's what the Bible says. That's not just what I say, but that's what the Word of God says. And so I need to understand, as I'm preparing for this trip, this trip is going to happen, and I need to make sure that I'm ready. And so I need to begin to look at some things. I need to begin to ask myself, am I prepared? Have I believed the truth? Am I hanging on to something that is real? So the first question that I would ask myself is the vehicle that I'm going to travel on, is it ready? Is it right? And is it going to be successful? So I need to ask myself, do I believe what the Bible says that I ought to believe? And so here's a simple rule that you know, people always want to discuss different things with me, and I am willing to discuss the Bible with anybody, but there are some deal breakers with me, right? People say, well, I love God, but I'm living in a sinful lifestyle, but I love God. You can't judge me. Well, that's not true. The Bible says that if you keep my commandments, you love me. If you don't keep my commandments, you don't love me. So if we're doing something contrary to what God said do, you don't love God. Now you can say, well, that's not fair. Well, take it up with the one who wrote the book. I didn't write it. I'm just kind of repeating to y'all something that was said. Amen? So if you get mad, don't get mad at me today, because I'm a good guy. Everybody loves me. Leastways in my world, y'all do. So I have to begin to ask myself, what is it that God expects from me? Well, the first thing that I have to do, if I want to be a part of and get a hold to the truth, I have to know the truth. The truth is, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Now, you know what that means? It means you're a sinner. You have to grab that. You have to believe that. You have to understand that you are a sinner. Now we can't take sin lightly. I had an indiscretion. Or I had a little oops in the road. Right? See, we want to marginalize what sin really is because we don't want to see how evil and hurtful and damaging sin is. Here's the truth. If you're a sinner, which we established, for all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, then you killed Jesus. Now, I'm going to say that again for you. If you ever sinned, your sin is why he went on the cross. Sinner, for Christ so loved the world, he gave himself. He died. He went to Calvary and died so we might be saved. There had to be a penalty. Jesus told the apostles in the garden when Peter took a sword out and cut an ear off. He said, hey, stop it. So don't you think that if I wanted to right now, I could pray and my Father would send legions of angels to deliver me from this hour? But for this hour came I into the world, he said. He said, I'm here because I have to die. Jesus settled it in the Garden of Gethsemane for himself when he said, Father, nevertheless, not my will, thine be done. And so he made a decision to die for lost humanity. So each of us who has sinned, my sin caused his death. When I recognize the weight of sin, then it stops being a nice little pretty thing that just a little, it was a evil, rotten, it caused Jesus to be beaten and broken. My sin caused that. I have to come to grips with that. I have to come to a place where I recognize what my salvation cost so that I understand that I wasn't just pretty good and needed just a little touch from God to make the difference, but I was lost on my way to hell without hope in this world until Jesus died on a cross for me. And if I want to get a hold to that, I have to enter into that. I have to come and I have to confess my sin. I have to recognize that I need God and what he did on Calvary to get to heaven. That I cannot get there any other way. You're not going to be able to work your way into heaven, and the good things that you're able to do in your life will not override the bad things that you did in your life, because our righteousness is as filthy rags before God. It is through his name. He said, there's no other name given. There's no other way that we can get to heaven. And so when they're challenging Peter and John because of the miracle that took place, you need to understand that we are miracles that have taken place, and the world's looking at the gate called Beautiful. There was a man who had been lame, and when Peter and John walked by at the hour of prayer, they walked by and they looked and they fastened eyes, and the man looked as though he was to expect something from them. He was expecting silver or gold, but Peter said, silver and gold have I none, but such as I have, give I thee. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. And the Bible says he reached down, got a hold to his hand, and snatched him up to his feet. And the man ran leaping and praising God and running into the temple. He couldn't go into the temple until this moment because he was lame and he was not worthy to enter in. But now Jesus healed him. Peter told the people there, this man is where he is because Jesus touched him. Oh, I want you to know that everybody in this room who is a Christian was laying somewhere in this world lame and broken and without a hope. And the only reason we can stand up and be somebody is because Jesus touched us. We don't stand on our own power, our own might, our own will, but I stand because Jesus of Nazareth, touched me. I don't know if you remember when he touched you, but I remember. I remember when I came to the altar of prayer, understanding that my sin cost Jesus his life. That it was my choices that I chose, not because I was forced into something, but because I willingly decided I wanted the pleasure of sin. And I chose to do those things. But when I came to that place, that altar of understanding and of repentance, I said to myself, God, I'm sorry, I'm a sinner, and I need a Savior. And Jesus, I recognize that you are that Savior. I recognized, Jesus, that on my own, I'll never make it. Oh, but I was there and I wept and I cried and I gave myself to Jesus because I wanted to be part of His family. I knew that the only hope I had was Jesus. And so I understood that I was able to stand because Jesus died on a cross, but He didn't stay dead. Amen. On the third day after they placed Him in the tomb, He came up. Amen. He came up out of death. He didn't stagger out, barely making it, but He came out of victory. Amen. He came out holding the keys, the authority over hell, death, and the grave. When I was a kid, I thought they had to roll the stone so He could get out, but that's not why they rolled that stone away. They rolled the stone away so humanity could get in and see He wasn't there no more, but He'd been raised. Amen. That's the reason that He was able to get in. And so I see this. I see this miracle that took place, and I see the vehicle upon which the church has to get into in order to get to heaven, and that is our faith in Christ and in Him alone. Amen. That we come to that place where we recognize that it was because He died on a cross for our sins. He was buried and raised on the third day. Because Jesus made a way, we're able to get into heaven because He is the first fruit from the dead. He is the only hope. So because Jesus died and rose again, I have to believe in Him and I have to walk after Him and follow Him. And if I do that, then I'm getting into the right place. Amen. I'm getting into the right vehicle. And I have to base everything else that I do on that truth. It's the truth that Jesus is my Lord and Savior. So I live a certain way. Because Jesus is my Lord and Savior, I don't do something. Because I believe in Jesus, I stopped doing other things that were contrary to what the Bible said. Can I tell you, it was a process for me. And when I came to that place and I gave my heart to God, I was going to say attacked, but that seems like a strong word. I was confronted by the God squad. Dwayne, you remember the God Squad, don't you? The God Squad, those are the ones who held the sign of telling you exactly what you had to do to be right for this church. You know, you had to walk right and spit white. No tobacco. You know, you couldn't do, you got to do this and you got to do that. You can't wear this and you can't wear that. The God Squad. Well, they showed up at the altar at salvation because they wanted to make sure I did it right. And they started telling me, Joe, all the things I could and couldn't do. And they didn't understand. My biggest problem wasn't cussing. My biggest problem wasn't drinking tobacco and wild women. My biggest problem was my anger and unforgiveness. And I was mad at them. They were the ones that upset me growing up. They're the ones who snitched on me when I did wrong. Oh, yeah, I bet none of them people would have made it in Angola. Every time I did something wrong, they'd call my mom and daddy, tell them. I hated them people. I did. I wanted to, I would seethe inside when I'd find out they'd done something they wasn't supposed to do and raise their hands in church like they were so holy. And they told on me. You know, my oldest son was in one of the bars in town, and I don't know who it is he saw, but somebody said, hey, boy, does your daddy know you're in here? Don't worry, I won't tell him. And my son looked at him and said, my daddy knows I don't live right. Does he know you're here? Because obviously there was somebody come to church here. See, those were when the God Squad showed up to explain to me what I had to do to be religious, I just got mad. Because that ain't what God's about. Jesus, that's what I build this on. Can I tell you, we get so caught up in the outside of the vessel. I want the outside to be clean. Clean yourself up, look like this, and then we'll know we can trust you. Can I tell you, the worst person in the world can clean up to look okay. It's the inside that God looks at. He's not as worried about the outside as He is the inside. Now, that's not a license to keep on sinning, but it is an understanding that we've got to change on the inside before the outside matters. And so that was a process. So I had to build my faith in Jesus and not in man, not in church, not in religion. Because so often we say, well, once I get saved, then I got to do certain things, and I got to stay saved by doing this and doing this and doing this. I don't get saved by the flesh, and I don't stay saved by the flesh. It is grace that got a hold of my heart. It is the love of God that reached down to me, and it's the grace and love of God that keeps me. I'm not going to be good because I did something good. I mean, let's just be honest, guys. All of us got some rot in us. Every one of us got some bad attitude. It don't take long to find it in some of us. Oh, come on now. Y'all know. We can find that rot pretty quick sometimes. You know, spouses, family, my kids know how to push my buttons. Oh, they know exactly what to say and do to watch daddy go. There's thought process that goes in my mind. I think about smacking them. But I'm getting older, and they're coming into their prime. And I'm afraid if I miss, if I catch them the first one, I got a chance. But boy, if I miss, they may. I'm too old. I don't want to do that. So that first process, all that process goes through that old rod. Then the spirit man inside of me says, don't do it. Let me handle them. I said, well, God, would you please just smack them extra hard for me? I had to build who I was, not on man's tradition, not on what people said. My mom and dad wanted me to be a certain way because that's what they thought I should be. My mom and dad wanted me to be close to God and love God, but they didn't want me to go into ministry. They knew how hard ministry was, and they were afraid if they could just get me to heaven, they were happy. You know, but God had more plans and God had a deeper place. But I had to get on board with Jesus. I had to make a decision that I was going to get on His training and on His do it in His way, because you can't get on board if you don't have Him as your Lord and Savior. And then I have to make sure that I'm invited on this trip. I know we think that I will make a decision when I'm ready and God will save me because He ain't got a choice. That's not true. You need to understand that you have to be drawn or you can't go. John 14:6. Jesus said unto him, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me. And it says in another place that unless He draws us, we can't go. Now, I want you to hear that. I want you to think about that. We think, I used to think, well, I will party and have a good time and I'll do all I want to do. And then when I see the end is near, I see the darkness of the train coming to get me, then I will repent and give myself to Jesus and go to heaven. I'll say a real quick prayer and God will let me in heaven. But that's not biblical. You need to understand that you can't. See, that is a teaching called human secularism. Right? It means that that's a teaching that it's about us. It's about me. It's all about me. It's not. It's not all about you. It's about Jesus. So what we begin and we're taught, hey, just give God a try. Anybody ever heard that? That's dumb. Don't think about it. Give God a try. Well, you tried drinking, you tried drugs, you tried sex, you tried everything else. Why don't you give old Jesus a try? Are you serious? See, you don't understand what you are. You don't understand the sinner that you are and the debt that you owe if you're thinking you can try God. That He would draw you is nothing but mercy. That after what you have done and after what you have been, that God's grace would reach to you and forgiveness would be extended to you is nothing but the miracle working of God. Try Him like a piece of cake. Don't like Him, just spit Him out. I'm telling y'all, that's a lack of understanding of God and you. You need to look into that true mirror. And you need to see you for who you really are. You need to be on your face begging God to save you. My dad at 16 years old walked out of a church and never felt the touch of God in his heart, didn't feel a tug at his heart. He was invited to church. He went to different things, never felt God again. 20 years he lived in the world and didn't feel the hand of God in his life. 20 years, nothing. Until one day when he opened up the Bible and he saw that scripture, trying to show my mama how dumb she was about the Bible. Found that in the Bible. Took it offshore. No man comes unless he's drawn. He said, close the Bible, turn off his light, and started crying. And he said, God, what's the matter? You don't want me? And he began to realize that he was eternity without God as hell. Can I tell you, you're not going to go to purgatory and suffer for a little while and then go to heaven. It is appointed a man wants to die, and after this, the judgment. Purgatory is something that is found in the Maccabeans. It is not, if you read it, you understand it doesn't say that. It wouldn't it be a good thought if. I want you to understand that if you die in your sin, separated from God, you have an eternity in the bowels of hell, which is then cast into a lake of fire. There is not three choices, there's two. Heaven or hell. We need to make a choice in ourselves that we're going to fall on our faces and we're going to pray, God, would you save me? That you can live in sin and not feel convicted. You got to understand that you have to be invited to come along this way, and you have to make an effort that when you feel the conviction of the Holy Spirit, you should never push it away until next time. I'm going to find a more convenient season. When it's more convenient. There's too many things that I want to do, Pastor. There's too many sins I haven't done. There are too many joys I haven't experienced. Let me tell you something. I can take you to Angola State Penitentiary, and you can walk with me up and down those tiers, and you can talk to those men, and you can ask them about the joy that was brought before them as they just wanted to have a little fun. They just wanted to do a little more. They just wanted to have a little taste of this and a little bit of that, but it brought them to a place. Most of them, 87%, will die in Angola because they just wanted to have a little fun. Many of them have told, well, I grew up in church and I knew the right and the wrong. Oh, but I just was drawn to the drugs. I was drawn to the scene. I was drawn to the streets. Why? Because they didn't choose Jesus. Instead, they chose flesh. They chose to do what they wanted to do. They didn't want to submit to the Word of God, so they didn't. They pushed it away. And because they pushed it away, the consequences of that was judgment in this world. Now, praise God, some of them have gotten on the right track. Some of them have gotten themselves right with God, and they're serving God, and when they die, they'll get to go to heaven. Amen? But they will die in Angola unless God does something different. And why? Because they chose their way rather than God's way. Oh, I think about the times that I sat, and I sat as far back as my daddy would let me. If they put a row against the back wall, that's where I would have sat, next to a door, so I could leave as soon as they said amen. Yeah, I'm not judging anybody sitting in the back next to the door. My daddy said one time, he said, hey, y'all want to put a chair by the wall so y'all be close to the door? I said, yeah. He said, you better shut up. Well, I thought it was a question. I didn't realize he was being, sarcastic. or maybe, I don't know. So you have to make a choice. So here I am trying to make a decision. Am I being drawn? I would sit back there and I would hold on to that pew because I wasn't going at Miss Elaine. They wouldn't, nobody going to make me. There was too much life for me to live. I heard all those testimonies of all those Christian people talk about how much fun they had in sin. The problem is they never talked about the consequences of that actions that they had in sin. They just talked about all the fun they had. Get together, talk. Oh, you remember when we used to do this? Oh, it was so much fun. But then we got saved. Right? We don't say, I remember those nights that I laid up wondering if I was going to live through the night because my heart was pounding out of my chest. I got up and I walked to the, looked out the window to see if my vehicle was there because I don't know, I don't remember getting home. I don't know how I got home. I remember hearing somebody got run over last night and I wondered, oh my God, was it me? Not that I get run over, but did I hit her or somebody? We don't talk about the relationships that were ruined, the friendships that were destroyed, all because I was just having a good time. We talk about sin as though it was a pleasure. We forget about the judgment that came after. And we need to do justice to the truth. We don't need to tell partial truth to our kids about how great sin was. We need to bring them into the place of where sin brought us to. I know that 90% of the people that come to church got here out of a misery, out of a hurt, out of a pain, out of a dark time. We found our way to where light was shining and God saved us and delivered us and forgave us. But it was because when we got into the church, there was a message of hope that went out and got a hold of us. And we felt the conviction of the Holy Spirit and we went down and received Jesus. And we got our invitation, amen? Yeah. But you got to hang on to God, because if you don't hang on to God, you find yourself in a situation where you go back to your seat and you said, I said a prayer, it's over with. But y'all, that's not, saying the prayer is not the end, it's the beginning of the journey. We think somehow I went down, I talked to some young kids, and they think, well, if I get baptized in water, I got to pray a prayer and get baptized, I'm done. I can go back to my life. Y'all, that's not true. We need to understand that giving my heart to God and being baptized, man, I'm just taking the first step into His kingdom. There's a whole world that God wants to open up to us in the spirit realm, the world where we understand who we are in Christ Jesus, the power not just to get ourselves out of a ditch, but the power to pull other people out of the ditch therein. Amen. God is pouring into the church an anointing and a power, and He wants us to reach out and pull other people, but we can't do that if we're half-heartedly preparing for this trip. But if I understand and I'm anticipation of this trip, it's keeping me focused on where I'm going. I refuse to be sidetracked with all the other things. And y'all, there are a lot of things in this world that are not evil, but they are distractive. A lot of things that we can get involved in that aren't in themselves bad, but they rob us of our focus of Jesus. They rob us of what we're called to do. And so it's learning to take everything that we do and understand that if Jesus is drawing me, I need to hold on. And so I need to make sure my vehicle's good. I need to make sure I've been invited. And then I need to make sure I can afford the cost of the trip. Right? Luke 14:28 says, for which of you intending to build a tower sitteth not down first and counteth not and count the cost, whether he has sufficient to finish it, least happily after he hath laid the foundation and is not able to finish it, all that behold it begin to mock him, saying, the man began a building and was not able to finish. This is one of the most difficult things for us to do, is to weigh the cost of anything. Young people dating, they don't want to weigh the cost. You don't understand, I'm in love. I remember I told my mom and dad, girl I was dating, and we broke up probably 100 times. I can't remember exactly, it's close. And she'd get mad at me, break up with me, I'd get mad at her, break up with her. I broke up with her one time, and my older brother called, act like he was me and made up. Because he sounded like me on the phone, he sounded like he's on the phone. And so she called back later and said, I just want you to know, I thought about it and I forgive you. For what? Yeah, we broke up again. But I remember we broke up and I was in my room and I was just crying and I was mad and my little brother was on the phone and I was back, you know, before you had one line. You know, and if you was on the line, that was it. Nobody getting through. You know, the only person who heard a busy signal was on the other side. Y'all remember them days? Some of y'all remember when you pick up the phone and you could hear other people talk. Well, I remember I got mad at my younger brother because he was on the phone. Didn't want to get off because he was talking to his girlfriend. She wouldn't no count. You know, I was trying to talk. I opened the phone so my girlfriend could call back and repent of her decision. My daddy came up there and he said, "Son, I know it feels bad, but it's going to be okay, I promise." And I looked at him with all the heart I could. "You don't understand. You've never been in love." Yeah, 15 years old, my daddy, "You've never been in love, old man." Married with kids, you don't know what love is. But you know what? Somebody said, "Well, Pat, it was just puppy love," but I'm going to tell you, it was real to the puppy. You hear me? And so it broke my heart, but I didn't want to count the cost. You know, there's costs that you say, "I want to date this person," or "I want to do this," or "I want this job. Man, I want this job. I'm going to make all this money. I'm going to go out here and do this." What is that money going to cost you? Where are you going to live? How are you going to pay your bills? What are you going to do if that job quits? We get security. Man, all these questions. When you're young, how many of y'all know you don't think about none of that? Chasing the money. You know, when we're young, it's more kind of like, I won't say that, but we're just chasing the money, right? It's all about the money. We don't care about nothing else. We get older, though, we start learning, and we learn to ask questions, but weigh the cost. I'm going to tell you, when you weigh the cost of salvation, we need to do that. We need to think about that. Are you willing? Are you willing to do what it's going to take to get out of sin? Because it ain't going to be easy. Can I tell you, sin don't let go easy. You're going to make choices. You think, "Well, I'll just do this and then I'll get right." But there are some things you get involved in, you can't just walk away from it. There are consequences to all your choices. Now, you can choose to do anything you want to, but you can't choose your consequence. Consequences come. People, you can choose to go to bed with whoever you want to go to bed with, but you can't choose the consequence of whatever they have in their life being in your life afterwards. You can choose to take any drug you want to take, but you can't choose the consequence of what that drug is going to do to your brain, what it's going to do to your body, what it's going to do to your life. You can choose to go any direction you want to go, but you cannot choose the consequence that's going to come from that road. There is a way that leads to life, and there is a way that leads to death. We're going to have to decide, are we willing to pay the price? Are you willing to do what's necessary? It may cost you a lot when you want to serve God. It cost me my friends when I got saved. I'm not just talking about good time friends. It cost me my friends because I couldn't go hang out with them because I knew what they were doing. And I knew if I showed up where they were, them doing what they were doing, it was just a matter of time before I was back doing what they were doing because I loved what they were doing. People can say, "I hated sin so much." I hated it and loved it at the same time. Had a love. It's like me and Mr. T. We got a love-hate relationship. I loved to hate him. But I did. I hated my sin, but I loved the way it made me feel. I loved the high. I did. I loved it. I wouldn't have done it. I was religious about my sin. I did it every day. I was more religious about my sin than most Christian folks was about their relationship with God. Because I didn't let a day pass. I didn't pay homage to my God. I served that thing too. It held me and I served it. When I got saved, I knew I was going to have to get away from all of that. When I yielded my life to God and God said, okay, I want you to be a preacher, I left church because I knew what was entailed in being a pastor. And I knew that if I was going to be a pastor, I couldn't do it part way. I couldn't do it a little bit. I had to give everything that I was to God because I refused to be a hypocrite who played church on Sunday and lived like the devil the rest of the week. If I couldn't serve God, I wasn't going to act like I was because I wasn't trying to impress nobody. I was trying to get peace in my heart. I don't know if you've ever been in turmoil 24/7, 365, but my life was messed up and I needed something to give me peace. And when I lay between me and this world, between God and sin, I had to count the cost. I had to begin to make some decisions about what I was going to do. And I'm going to tell you, my decision to serve God cost me my job. Because God told me to go to Bible college. I didn't want to go to Bible college. I was making good money. I figured I could take some correspondence courses. You know, why do I got to go to Bible college and quit my job? Now I'm going to take all my money I've been saving and pay it on Bible college. But I did. I said, God, if that's what you want, that's what I'll do. So I gave up my job. I went to Bible college and I did my Bible college thing till God said okay. And then I got married And I went back offshore. I didn't want to go back offshore after I got out of it. You know, I thought, well, God, you made me quit my job. You give me another job, pays good money. And God said, I will, offshore. Sent me back to work. Went back offshore. I was there 3 years. And then God told me, now quit your job now. I said, God, I don't want to quit now. I'm making good money again. I'm preaching one. Ain't no way, girl, sit down. I determined within myself that I was never going to tell God no and that I was going to pay whatever the cost was. Can I tell you that serving God is going to cost you? It's going to cost you more than you want to pay sometimes. But you got to make a decision before you get started who you are. You're going to have to make a decision. Do you belong to God or not? If you're God's, then you don't have a choice. You're going to have to pay the hard price. You want to get to heaven? You got to get on board Jesus' way. You can't do it your way. Because what's going to happen is you're going to do good for a little while, and then you're going to stumble away and fall back into your sin. That's what happens. You can try all you want to your way, and you can clean up a little bit. But if you don't do it God's way, you're going to fall away again. And you're going to keep repeating a cycle over and over and over until you finally understand it's going to cost you what you're holding on to. Because that's what happens to us, isn't it? We want to hold on to this one thing. This I like this though, God. And God says, you're going to have to give it up if you want to get to heaven. Because that's part of the price. Are you willing to pay it? I had to pay I still find there's things I got hid God wants. And as I get closer to Him, He reveals to me, I want you to give me that. There's been times I said, but God, why? It ain't a big deal. It's just a little one. It's just a little thing. It ain't hurting nobody. You know, I like it. Nobody else even thinks it's wrong, Jesus. What's the big deal? He says, I want your heart, and that has it. Give it to me. I found out that anything that I didn't want to give to God was because it had a hold of me in a way God didn't want to have a hold of me. God wants me to give Him all of me. You know why? Because He's worth it. God's worth it. I don't know what it is you think you have that's worth holding on to and missing God, but I promise you it ain't worth it. It's not. Doesn't matter what you think. I'm telling you right now, you give it to God. And you watch how God fills that place with a greater love, a greater power, a greater peace. Because whatever you're hanging on to other than Him is fleeting. It's not eternal and it will not last you. It'll come up short. But if you can just pay that price, and if you remember where you're going. You got to remember where you're headed. You can't forget we're headed to heaven. It's worth it. It's going to be a long trip. And it's going to be uncomfortable trips. It's going to be a costly trip, but it's going to be a worthwhile trip. And I don't know where you are today, but I believe that if you want to get to heaven, you have to make sure that you've done those things. Has God called you into His kingdom? If He hadn't, you need to be praying, God, what's wrong with me? God, why haven't you drawn me? God, why haven't you led me to this place? Maybe there's been times you've hung on to the chair and said, I'm not moving forward. I'm going to sit here. He'll quit pretty soon and I'll be okay. And now it's longer and further between that you feel that in your heart. Long time since you felt the drawing like that. Maybe it's because you're allowing the enemy to harden your heart. You don't want to be hard-hearted. You can miss heaven that way. You'll miss that trumpet when it sounds. You don't want to do that. Next week, we're going to talk about GPS, God's positioning spirit. You got to know where to get on. Have you gotten on? See, everybody's getting on the road somewhere. This morning, either you're getting back on the road going the wrong way, or you're going to get on the road the right way. Because we come to a decision this morning. If I have every head bowed, if my prayer team could come forward. Coming to a decision this morning. Do I want to go to heaven? Am I willing to pay the price? Am I willing to give whatever it takes to get to heaven? Well, those are decisions that we have to make. And every head's bowed, every eye's closed. If that's you and you say, Pastor, I want to go to heaven and I want to do whatever it takes. I'm willing to pay the price. Just slip your hand up and say, that's me, Pastor. I see the hands all over the building. Thank you. I'll just put them up and put them back down. I'm ready to pay the price, Pastor. Maybe you're here and you say, Brother Packy, I've been on the road. I'm trying my best to get to heaven, but I've been getting beat up pretty bad. And I just need some grace in my life. Could you just slip your hand up? Amen. Thank y'all. Thank y'all. I'm going to ask you to stand to your feet all across the building. Father, you saw all of the hands that were raised. And Lord, you know all of our hearts. You know, Lord God, the situations and the places and the struggles. So God, I ask that right now you would empower us to be everything that you have called us to be. Father, I ask that you would help us to get on the right lane, the narrow, straight road, that God, we would make you our home. And Father, I ask that you would help those that have been struggling, those that just need some grace on the road, that you would pour into them right now in Jesus' name. If you need prayer, you come and we'll pray with you.